and he got Walter in. I mean, that was his best signing, Walter.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about that. I love Walter. I love the two of them. Because Graeme is like that. Graeme was, he was full on. But Walter, you could go to Walter if things weren't going as planned on the pitch on a Saturday. You'd go, but you couldn't with Graeme. And the best thing that happened to me was whenever, I'm saying the best thing, but he bought Gary Stevens. And I said to Graeme, I said, such a strange one. Do you not think he's too good for the reserves?
This is Ibrox. Listen, Jimmy, I'm going to come back to you because before we started to speak about the Antwerp game, you alluded to your meeting with Graeme Souness prior to him indicating that he was going to be in Glasgow that summer. Let us know a little bit about how that fitting into that Souness revolution at Ibrox, and it was a revolution at that time. Let us know what that was like to be involved in that.
Well, I was the luckiest man in the world. I was at West Bromwich Albion with Ron Saunders. And Ron arrived. Johnny Tales was the manager of West Brom whenever I was there, and I loved Johnny and Norman Hunter and Nobby Tales and the great staff. I loved it. And then Ron Saunders came and, I just didn't get on with them. Yeah. It was my first game, Spurs away. They beat us 4-5-0. It was his first game. He arrived in the middle of January. And Nobby Stiles was the caretaker manager for 6 games. And we were around second, third, bottom of the league. And Nobby was caretaker. And we win 2, drew 2, lost 2. So we'd settle things down. And Ron came. And he had his run up and down hills Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday. I mean, it was horrific. And we could beat 5-0. And he says, after the game, he changed the whole team around. And after the game, he said, in all my days in the game, I have never seen a bunch of unprofessional, unfit players in all my life, the news.
Wow.
So next week, he says, we'll be finding higher hills and you'll be running up and down these hills every day all week. And I said, excuse me, Gaffer, can I say something? I said, so I'm taking that as a slant as me as professional. There's nothing wrong with my fitness and there's nothing wrong with my professionalism. Are you telling me that the cause of the result today, and it's nothing to do with your team selection, where you made 6 changes after a team that went unbeaten, 2 wins, 2 draws and 2 defeats, and you changed the whole team, so it's nothing to do with your team selection? He was that close. He walked right up to me and he says, congratulations, you've just played your last game for West Bromwich Albion. And I never kicked another ball. So can you imagine, I was from January 85. Can you imagine, I was training with the kids. Whenever I get the phone call, came back from the World Cup in Mexico, I was training with the kids at West Brom pre-season. And Saunders calls me over and he says, come here. What? I know Bobby Williamson. I knew when he played for Rotherham and I like him. He says, so he's over Rangers at the minute. I says, I know that. I said, well, he's coming down the road. And you're going up the road, straight swap. I know where you get the short straw, that one.
Can I keep this thing off your face? Yeah. All right, Gaffer, whatever you insist.
I run off that pitch. I was only training the kids, and I run off that pitch, got my boots, got my gear, jumped in the car, drove back to Manchester, then drove to Scotland, and that was it. Signed on a Friday, and we played Hibs on Saturday. And I've been here ever since, you know, so luckiest man in the world. But what he did then was, and I thought that what's happening here, and then Terry, I wasn't the first signing, not saying the first signing, but at that time he bought Terry Butcher, England captain, yeah. Chris Woods, England goalkeeper. They were all coming in. I thought this is going to be great. And that's just the way Graeme was. He just wanted to surround himself with good players. And good players, I mean, Butcher and Woods and all these boys, and good staff. And he got Walter in.
I mean, that was his best
signing, Walter.
Yeah.
There was no doubt about that. I love Walter. I love the two of them, because Graeme is like that. Graeme was, he was full on, but Walter, you could go to Walter if things weren't going as planned on the pitch on a Saturday, but you couldn't with Graeme. And the best thing that happened to me was, was whenever, I'm saying the best thing, but he bought Gary Stevens. And I said to Graeme, I said, that's a strange one. Do you not think he's too good for the reserves? He says, aye. He says, but would you like to take the reserves? And it was my first insight into the side of the game.
Yeah.
And I'm glad I did it, because there's an opportunity to go and play somewhere else. I said, no, I'm going to take the reserves and see if I can, with Big Peter McCloy and then John McGregor, and see if I like the side of the game. And I'm glad I did, because I meant I was in the office every morning with Graeme, and I seen another side to him, which I didn't see as a player. I didn't see it as a player. But at 9 o'clock in the morning, I seen a side to him that I really got to know the man. I thought, great. But at 10:30, from 9 o'clock to 10:30, he could talk about anything topical, anything going on in the world. Anything, not just football, anything. Clever.
So that was something I was going to say to you. Obviously, when he came over in the 80s, I'm sure he was 33, 34, so young by any standard, younger than what I am now, certainly. Probably Thomas as well, although he'd probably try to pretend otherwise.
This filter's not working, guys.
How do you think Graeme Souness managed to, because Walter Smith wasn't there from the outset, how do you think he managed to balance that so perfectly between being a player and, I imagine, wanting to play and being the gaffer as well, to all intents and purposes?
I'm sure Walter helped him a lot.
Yeah.
I'm sure, because maybe there was times whenever Graeme would go over the top. You know?